Okay, so well, hi everyone. Well, first of all, I would like to say thank you to Joanna Mikiljenska and Agata Stasinska and the rest of the team for organizing this conference. I don't think that we have so many opportunities to get together, put in common and debate all these issues about queer reproduction and kinship. So, well, to do it in this wonderful place is also very nice. And yeah, it's a huge pleasure also to present here these two long-time colleagues and friends. And what I was thinking this morning, that talking about kinship, well, they are part of my intellectual and affectionate kinship, so it's just really nice to be presenting them. We're going to start with Ana Cristina Santos, and I'm going to read just quickly a brief version of the CV, okay? Otherwise we maybe lose some time. Ana Cristina Santos is a sociologist. She holds a PhD in Gender Studies, University of Leeds, UK. She is a senior researcher at the Centre for Social Studies, University of Coimbra, an honorary research fellow at the Birkbeck Institute for Social Research, University of London. Cristina has been involved in a number of research projects exploring issues of gender, sexual and reproductive rights, citizenship, disability and human rights. And in 2013, she was awarded this European grant, and she's now coordinating this huge project, which is a comparative study on citizenship, care and choice, the micropolitics of intimacy in Southern Europe. So, okay, all yours.
All right, thank you very much, Gracia, and thank you all for being here in one of the best days in terms of the weather, and you're all sitting there, so I hope it will be worthwhile. I want to start by thanking the team for inviting me here as well. And to let you know that for those of you, and I know there's a couple at least going to the conference we are co-organizing in Lisbon in September, the Non-Monogamous Conference, this is going to be my first round of the paper that I'm planning to present in another version, hopefully there. So, you know, feel free to leave now or to leave then, okay? Okay. So I'll start by saying a couple of things about care, but I don't want to dwell too much on that, actually. Care is a particularly loaded notion. The cultural meanings attached to care cannot be disentangled from the context in which care emerged in the concerns of researchers, social workers, politicians, and other decision makers. Care can be generally described as domestic-based provision of unpaid services to vulnerable individuals vis-à-vis a retracting welfare state in an increasingly aggressive market-oriented ethos that creates more and more vulnerability. In order to grasp its implications, we should add to this description the unsaid threat, disguised as altruistic good practice, taking care in order to be cared for, fed by the Judeo-Christian ideology and the charitable lending hand. We do to others as we hope to receive in an abstract, unforeseen future. So care emerges not as a right or a guarantee of citizenship, dignity and well-being, but rather as a voluntary and selfish assistance or help. But care is loaded in at least two other important ways. First, it points towards an objectification of the person in need of care. One takes care of children, one takes care of pets. And indeed, care comes into the picture as a consequence of situations of distress, disease, accident, weakness, deterioration. Care is a reaction to something negative and unexpected, something that causes insufficiency. In a culture which highly values autonomy and independent living, being an adult who is cared for deprives oneself from a sense of self-sufficiency and agency. Of course, autonomy is overrated. Nobody is fully 100% independent, self-sufficient, autonomous. However, the dominant, that is market-oriented, tale of success is not easily compatible with the recognition that we are mutually dependent and that we fail. The second ground on which care is particularly loaded is gender. Care is gender-loaded. Historically, we all know this, women have been responsible for care provision. As in paid labor, care provision in the domestic sphere is seen as a natural extension of the duties that are attached to the female role. Early critical accounts of care have provided an in-depth analysis of the gendering of care and how it became entangled with women's morality and the source of gender oppression. Even more recent discussions run the risk of reinforcing such morality by focusing exclusively on the ethics of care and the correspondent identity essentialism based on gender. So to reiterate, care lends itself to a perspective that strives on power asymmetry. Moreover, it is presented as a moral duty, a responsibility with strict roles and expectations that replicate a patriarchal heteronormativity. So therefore, in this very, very brief incursion, we already recognize several of the difficulties in addressing care as a positive aspect of a gender-fair citizenship regime. But then came good news. Then came feminist and queer readings of care, turning this paradigm upside down, providing an alternative analysis through which care can be portrayed as both a public good and a potentially emancipatory personal device. So as Kessler puts it, when care is practiced outside the traditional family, it can be deeply subversive of gender, race, class, and sexuality norms. By ascribing analytical value to the margins of care provision, academia fulfills one of the most challenging and important tasks, providing social and politically relevant tools that contribute to transforming ways of thinking, of doing, of enacting. A group which has been at the margins of theoretical thoughts and social policy around care provision is LGBT polyamorous people. But before getting into the implications of poly to rethinking care and citizenship, let me take you on a tour about beginnings, belongings, starting points. So where do I start? Contrary to the most resilient cultural expectations throughout the days we have known, our intimate biographies are anything but linear, anything but extraordinary and peculiar. All it takes is to speak to therapists and to sex workers, two of the professions which gather more knowledge about the range of human experience than any expert in sociology of family might dream of. Each story is indeed different. There is never a starting point, a unique reason to justify why and how we are at this particular situation instead of a different one. Still, we search for a reason. We produce narratives, intimate, personal life stories that strive to account for who we are today. This is precisely what me and my team in the Intimate ERC research project have been asking a series of people to do. So we ask them this question. As you know, I am interested in intimate relationships. Please tell me the story of your life, all the events and experiences that have been important to you personally. You can start wherever you want, it takes as long as you want, I will not interrupt. We ask them, self-identified, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer people of all sorts, ages between 25 and 45, living in Lisbon, Madrid, or Rome, to trust us their stories, whatever comes to mind, whatever they feel is important to them personally. And in this exercise, different people do different things. Some start by telling us the first time they fell in love, or the first time they had a long-term relationship, the first time they had sex, or they cohabited with a partner. Some start from now, the time of the interview, and then time travel as far as memory stretches, and sometimes it stretches for quite a while. Others gather memories according to themes. Lovers, friends, platonic relationships, cats. Others organize their story around turning points, before coming out, after coming out, before transitioning, after transitioning. You get the picture. But the point is, even when we all fail to acknowledge it, each of our interviewees started from the beginning. The beginning is not a fixed, tidy category. The beginning is not necessarily attached to a list of items arranged in chronological order. The beginning of their story is what each of them decided to speak first. If we are to discuss sex, love, intimate biographies, the beginning cannot be anything but self-perceived. And random and extraordinary, as original as fingerprints. So before getting into the gist of what I prepared for you today, let me briefly take you on a tour that highlights two of the starting points, two biographical triggers of this talk. These biographical notes are important because we do not just produce knowledge. We make choices based on research interests and more on an array of constraints that include cuts and fears about not getting funded or failing to achieve a certain status or respect from our peers who think we are perhaps a tad too politicized, a bit too angry, a killjoy, as Sarah Emmett has put it better than anyone before her. So as situated researchers, it seems wise to explain what the situation was before we got here. So trigger one, a trip to the museum. Perhaps surprisingly, our tour starts at the Museum of the History of Polish Jews, Pauline, recently launched in Warsaw. The trigger there was an all-time favorite, which I was poignantly reminded of as I entered the main exhibition of this impressive museum. A sentence on the wall read in different languages out there: build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat their fruit, take wives and beget sons and daughters. This pretty much sums it up. It encapsulates what is it that, as we grow old to become proper adults, are expected to do. Find a place to live, presumably after getting a job. Find food to put in your plate. Mate, cohabit, reproduce. Mate, cohabit, reproduce. So this takes me, us, to another stop. No, this is not the other stop. It is. To another stop in this tour. The UK, 10 years ago, where I met Joanna, Agatha, Robert Cooper, where I got my PhD degree in gender studies in SIGS and worked for several years in an amazing international research project called FemCit, Gendered Citizenship in Multicultural Europe, coordinated by Sasha Rosenil. Funded by the European Commission during 4 years, FemCit was a rather ambitious and fantastic project that gathered 69 researchers throughout Europe. I was responsible for the study on intimate citizenship in Portugal and the impact of the women's movements there. FemCit was officially over in 2011, but the thing is, with large studies as yours, it's never really over, so they tend to perpetuate way beyond our wildest dreams. It's still ongoing, we are still publishing and planning writing retreats. So in 2013, together with colleagues from FemCit, we co-edited a special issue of the journal Citizenship Studies. This special issue was called Reproduction and Citizenship, Reproducing Citizens. The main argument behind the idea for submitting it as a proposal was our perception, based on comparative work, that there are certain rules attached to this fantasy around adulthood. One of them is the procreative norm. So it basically describes the assumption, expectation, and cultural demand that biological procreation should occupy the center ground of the social formation, that intimate relationships, sexuality, and the wider organization of the social should be driven by and structured around a naturalized notion of a primary, fundamental, procreative imperative. So we considered how the state and mainstream culture was encouraging good citizens to have children, and also the construction of the good citizen as properly procreative, which has overwhelmingly meant procreative within the context of the co-residential, heterosexual, gender-normative couple. But the procreative norm is not alone, does not operate on its own. And in fact, we are just finishing the manuscript of a co-authored book on another of these rules, what we framed as the couple norm, that is, the cultural expectation that when one becomes an adult should not remain single, and parallel to this, the social and legal validation that stems from the marital status when it is deemed as an acceptable, adequate marital status. And this leads me to the main point of the talk today. It is not about the pressure to be heterosexually partnered so much, but most of all, about the pressure to be a committedly monogamous partner. A monogamy wrestler, if you will. So, the study intimates citizenship, care and choice, the micropolitics of intimacy in Southern Europe, is a large cross-national multidisciplinary research project funded by the European Research Council for 5 years between 2014 and 2019. I've got a couple of leaflets here. I don't want to forget So, you know, feel free to take one with you if you want. So it is conducted at the Center for Social Studies, University of Coimbra, which is in Portugal, not in Spain, okay? And it gathers a team of six researchers, including myself as the PI and one research manager. So you've got nice pictures of the team there. It also gathers an international advisory group who we invite to contribute as thematic consultants. And you may recognize at least one of the pictures in there, right? You do. Okay, so conducted at SESH, Intimate is the first in-depth comparative study on sexual citizenship in Italy, Portugal and Spain. So guided by the fundamental sociological question of how law and social policy adjust to and or shape the practices and expectations of individuals concerning personal life, this research investigates processes of transformation of intimacy starting from life experiences of self-identified lesbian, gay, bisexual and transgender people, taking into consideration different family and relational models. So Intimate is based on three major strands. Micropolitics of partnering, which is the one we are conducting at the moment, micropolitics of parenting, and then in a couple of years we'll be dealing with the micropolitics of friendship. So the empirical studies are primarily based in in-depth interviews using BNIM, biographic narrative interpretive method, and also semi-structured interviews with experts, legal experts, researchers, decision makers, health professionals, activists. So where does this lead us into polyamory? So currently we are right in the middle of fieldwork on strand one, on partnering, which includes two studies, a study on lesbian coupledom in Madrid, Lisbon and Rome, and a study on polyamorous relationships, again, in these same capital cities. Within the Intimate project, we consider polyamorous relationships in its potential to offer new understandings of doing relationships and challenging the heteronormative constraints of mainstream coupledom. Being aware of the political and theoretical implications of using polyamory, we decided to retain the use of this notion based on the increasing mainstreaming of the word in the media and popular culture in the countries involved in the study. More and more people know what poly means, even if they are not aware of its specificities. People who have heard of polyamory know it is different from swing practices or occasional sex encounters or fuck buddies, for instance. Polyamory sets people's minds into the mode of relationship and all the things that are culturally attached to the imaginary around doing intimate relationships, aspects to do with commitment, support, care, responsibility, attachment, length. And to us in the Intimate project, polyamory is to a great extent a catchword to include people who engage in intimate relationships with more than one person with the knowledge of everyone involved in the relationship. So three points have already emerged from very, very partial, ongoing preliminary data. May I remind you that we are in the middle of the fieldwork for this study, so you know. The first point is that women seem to be more willing to participate in the polyamorous study, and that to us came as a surprise. And you know, there are several things we may anticipate that justify this apparent willingness of women volunteering to do our study. It may be related to the fact that in two of the three countries, the polyamorous study is conducted by women. It may be related also to the fact that women historically have had less of a voice and feel in this study seen this study as an opportunity to participate, to tell their stories. That remains to be seen. Another point is that in some contexts, it has been reported to be harder to come out of the poly closet than to come out as lesbian or as gay. So some people have told us that when they told their parents, for instance, "Oh, I'm lesbian, by the way," or yeah, they didn't face as much prejudice as when they went back to them a few years later on and said, "Well, yes, and on top of that, I don't want to have a you know, an exclusive relationship. I have an open relationship or something along those lines. Also, participants produce highly self-reflexive narratives that amount to the idea of relational citizenship as a process, ongoing, rather than a fixed demand around a set of formal rights. And this takes us to the emergence of what we're calling the normal slut. Normalizing the slut. This is where the politics of normalization that we know from the queer critique of same-sex marriage, for instance, and before that, enter into the realm of non-monogamy. Participants get the usual questions when they came out as poly. What about children? What about when you get old? This is a phase, right? And more. And with that set of questions and unspoken suspicion comes the need to explain, to create and rehearse a narrative, a persuasive one, aiming at tidying up so well that not even you believe in it, but it is designed to calm down social panic around non-monogamy. And so the rehearsed narrative very often evolves around love, romantic, responsible, committed, caring love. For several people, but caring love. These arguments echo Michael Warner's earlier writings about shame, dignity, and sexual politics. He contends that the LGBT movement is trying to clean itself and that cleanliness is, in this sense, is equivalent to desexualizing politics in order to transform it into something that, and I quote, you could take home to mom. So drawing on Warner's work, Richardson argues that there is a shift in the cultural meanings attached to being lesbian or gay, which is increasingly constructed as a social rather than a sexual category. This shift translates itself into a normative focus on the desirability and necessity of marital-style sexual coupledom. In other words, quote, the normative emphasis is on the loving lesbian gay couple living together in marital style relationships, rather than the rights of the individual sexual actor. These changes, Richardson suggests, contribute to the creation and recognition of the normal gay, who, according to Seidman, is, quote, expected to be gender conventional, link sex to love and a marriage-like relationship, defend family values, personify economic individualism, and display national pride. When in fact it is messier and richer than that. It is experimental, yes, in the sense that for each person it will be different and extraordinary. So as ethically queer researchers, we need to contribute to reverse the dominant paradigm through which issues of care and relationships are being addressed. It is probably too late to reject equality claims altogether based on a simplistic critique to assimilationism. People outside our cozy bubble understand that all people are equal under the law and the eyes of God. They have more trouble in the understanding that some of us do not really care about the sort of equality they have to offer. Therefore, we might consider the need to work from common ground, to play the card of being on the same page, even when we know that that is hardly the case because each page is different. Maybe we need to start from what average LGBTIQ people are saying and doing, how intimacy is constructed and managed on a daily basis, and what does practice say about what is missing from literature and social policy. So instead of ditching the notions of care or of citizenship, including intimate citizenship, maybe we can continue the never-ending task of pushing its boundaries in a way which is not about inventing the wheel, but rather simply acknowledging the ways in which mainstream understandings of these notions do not tell the whole story. And this is where relational citizenship may become handy. Ah, this is in the wrong place. Oh. So, shaped by significant developments regarding sexual and reproductive citizenship, the complex arrangements to do with care and choice in the context of non-monogamy push decision makers, theorists included, to change the ways in which citizenship is framed and enacted by law, social policy, and social cultural outlets. Therefore, we are suggesting the notion of non-monogamous relational citizenship to capture both the disjunctions and possibilities for reframing how we perceive, represent, and manage our intimate lives. So, perceive, what did I just say? Represent and manage. So, relational citizenship as self-perceived can be about being partnered, self-identifying as non-single, or being in a relationship. Relational citizenship as a representational system, for instance, in the context of institutions, public institutions, to renew our ID card in some of the countries, or to register your child, which recently happened to me. The first question was my name, the second question on the form was my marital status. Okay. Also in the context of the family, what I've just told you, that it was rather difficult to come out as poly to one's parents, for instance, or who gets to go to weddings, who gets to go to Christmas dinners or funerals. And also relation citizenship and the daily management of intimacy, issues to do with more care, to care about, to be cared after, to extend care, and also who's in, who's out, and what it means to be in or out. So relational citizenship describes the ways in which we self-perceive and are represented by others as being partnered. It aims at addressing questions of identity and social validation, cultural norms and expectations, opportunities and obstacles that stems from the relational status of each individual. It includes significant relationships, intimate, but not necessarily sexual or romantic. It can include cohabitation or not. Relational citizenship highlights the immense diversity in the way we construct our intimate biographies. There is no protocol, no guidelines, no formula. We do as we go along. People start in different and equally extraordinary places. So, to conclude, care can mean to watch over, look after, or assist in practical ways, as well as to feel attachment and fondness. And I've just quoted Lynn Jameson. Against the backdrop of heteronormative law and social policy, there is a range of care practices which are particularly crucial in the context of economic crisis, when the welfare state fails to provide adequate support. In southern European countries, the importance of a strong welfare society that compensates for the shortcomings of state provision has been already identified. So if we are to reframe the paradigm of care rather than rejecting it, questions we need to pose ourselves include the following. How relevant is the framework of care to think about LGBT experiences in Italy, Portugal, and Spain? So aggravated by the economic crisis, caring for strangers, care amongst friends, care provided by children, collective action as a form of care, the negotiation of care practices between care provider and receiver, the need to defamiliarize care as well. Based on current experience in Southern Europe, to what extent can we think of care as a positive, transgressive experience? What specific challenges and opportunities are posed by polyamory relationships to the current paradigm of care provision? And how can poly-intimate biographies contribute to rethinking care and citizenship? So a similar exercise can be suggested in relation to the notion of citizenship, instead of just getting rid of it. Gradually, the notion of citizenship is being pushed and stretched to include demands that had been previously left out. Post-structuralist contributions to citizenship theory have advanced the understanding of citizenship as highly contingent, fragmented, and dynamic. Today, it is argued that citizenship can be understood both as an academic and political concept and as a lived experience. In such context, it seems important to consider the mutual implications of intimacy and citizenship, exploring the extent to which issues of partnering, parenting, and friendship are important aspects of being and becoming recognized as a citizen. Given this challenge, the intention is to move beyond the theoretical dispute between intimate and sexual citizenship in order to advance reciprocal ways in which these and other perspectives on citizenship can and should contribute to the politics and practices of intimacy in everyday life. The notion of relational citizenship based on the intimate biographies of everyday LGBT polyamorous people, may be an important step towards reframing care, choice, and uniqueness of each extraordinary individual story. And before finishing my talk, I want us to watch and listen very careful to the lyrics of a video. So let's see if it works.
She was home, she was a swan, she was out, she was a tiger, and a tiger in the wild is not tied to anyone. When she was lost, she was a tormented found her on the road. I gave her water and a rose, and as she stretched, the sun rose. Go.
So, 30 seconds, just to Okay, so part of the lyrics say, when she was home, she was a swan. When she was out, she was a tiger. And the tiger in the wild is not tied to anyone. Later on, she says, women to survive must be unfaithful to their child. Of all the wonders of the world, she was a lady with a bird. She must have had so many lives. Was it the first? Was it the last? And it's part of the what I had prepared to tell you, well, to share with you today, is exactly this. There is no starting point. And because we keep on being defined by the intimate others with whom we relate, maybe we need to consider the importance of relational citizenship without losing sight of the importance of our uniqueness and, you know, the importance of the individual in all of this. So thank you very much for your attention. Last slide. Follow us on Facebook. Where is it? Yes. Thank you.
Okay, so now we're gonna go on with Ulrika Dahl. He's gonna read her biography. He's a cultural anthropologist and associate professor of gender studies at Södertörn University of Stockholm. Prior to her, recently started an innovative project within kinship in the Baltic region. She has written extensively on feminist theory, gender equality, heteronormativity, and above all, queer femininities and the figure of the femme. She's the author of a number of articles and a bunch of anthology chapters, and also of the monographs, Skamgrepp, Swedish, and Femmes of Power, Exploding Queer Femininities with De La Grace Volcano, which is such a wonderful book, I have to say. And also Ulrika is a co-editor of Landa Nordica, a Nordic journal of LGBT queer studies, and recently edited a special issue on queer kinship and reproduction, which is here. So,
30 minutes. Okay, 30 minutes, right. All right, so let me begin by saying thank you to the organizing team and to all the fantastic presenters already. It's been a really great event. Those of you who've heard me before know that a couple of things are always true about me. I speak really fast, I'm polemical, and I'm really bad with technology. So we'll see how this goes. I don't even know how to... Right. So, given all the amazing things that we've been hearing for the last few days, what might be left to say here? What could I possibly contribute? I want to begin in anecdotes, as we do as anthropologists. So here we go. I went from feeling relieved that as a dyke I was free from expectations of motherhood, to going on an emotional roller coaster of IVF treatments, suddenly treated like a real woman and a potential mother walking into the clinic with my gay friend, to being told that I was in fact infertile, medically speaking. Agnes, a white lesbian in her early 50s, explained as she recalled her attempts to get pregnant with her then-girlfriend and a gay male couple friends about 10 years ago. Until her family-dreaming girlfriend was diagnosed with endometriosis, pregnancy had been inconceivable to Agnes. While she considers herself to be too middle-class professional to be butch, as she puts it, Agnes insisted that her lesbian gender was far from that of the typical woman. 3 years later, many IVFs via the Swedish welfare state and significant emotional cost to all later, the conception plan had failed, and thus the imagining a futurity of family together with these people, she had become both potentially fertile and infertile. Both of the couples eventually split up, entering into new constellations of lovers, friends, and legal spouses. And for Agnes, attempting to achieve pregnancy simply marks a moment in a longer queer lifespan where life could have taken a different path, but it didn't. In other words, the idea of involuntary childlessness is not a narrative that fits for her. Karin, a white upper-middle-class professional in her 30s who recently left her wife and co-parent of a girl who is 4 for a straight girl she calls Hottie, rolls her eyes as she talks about her experiences with attempting to get pregnant. The hormones drove me crazy. I had a complete breakdown, she says. We spent years fighting Swedish law to ensure that not only one, but two lesbian partners could be inseminated. When I was finally given the chance to carry our second child, the hormonal mess made me realize that I was staying in that relationship more because I wanted another kid, and the Swedish state wouldn't allow me the donor sperm unless I remained with my wife. Now my ex tells me that she feels like our legally recognized shared custody means that I am actually taking the child from her. Well, I'm going to Denmark on my own because Hadi doesn't want kids, and I will keep trying for as long as my savings last. For Karin and a range of other urban lesbian friends, lesbian women who are fertile, fortunate, and forthcoming, there are, in theory, a range of ways to enhance life through reproduction. As long as you know your rights, have a flexible work schedule, a visa that allows you to cross borders, and a savings account. What all of them seem to be surprised by, however, are the intense affects that seem to accompany hormone treatments, breastfeeding, and encounters with a world that keeps asking who the real mother is. Well, I'm often told that I must be super fertile, built for carrying babies. It worked with a turkey baster the second time daddy came around to jerk off, laughs Ylva, a woman of color in her early 30s. In Ylva's four-clover parental constellation, who carried the son is downplayed in the spirit of parental equality, given that legal regulations only recognize two parents. As two married couples, Ylva and the other parents have their own moral contracts, but tensions often arise around how the surrounding world views their arrangement. Mm-hmm. Expressing what Swedish researchers have called a discourse on equality, Ylva's gestational motherhood is often downplayed, and it is often remarked how much the son resembles the other, white mother, she explains, adding that there is a big difference between how the world views the brown child of a white mother and a brown, muscular, lesbian mother of a white passing child. Ylva, who mostly thought having a kid would be kind of a fun thing to try, notes that many consider her to be lucky in having achieved pregnancy with little financial cost, which points to what I think are the new hierarchies of fertility that are happening. While white lesbians often lament the heteronormative encounters that they have with Swedish healthcare professionals, Ylva finds the racist assumptions that just because she's a muscular, short-haired woman who rarely wears a dress, people presume she's either butch or trans, and that her identity as a lesbian brown woman and mother to a light-skinned kid is too hard for a white world to grasp. In a constellation when the other parents have more resources than her, who was herself raised by a single mother, the joint project of raising a kid in a queer way and agreeing on values is a rather bumpy road, but for very other reasons that is commonly explained. So these are really rich and complex stories, slightly altered here to protect anonymity, and they're about experiences of fertility, pregnancy, gender, and parenthood that I've heard within my recently started project, Reproducing Queer Futures in Sweden. And really what I'm going to be talking about today is what's not in these stories. In this project, for which the empirical work has merely started, I'm interested in how queers, that is, non-heterosexual, non-gender-conforming people, who claim belonging to a larger queer or transnational community in Sweden, understand and make sense of family and futurity in the context of changing legal regulations, a growing range of reproductive technologies, and of course, everyday love and everyday life and love drama. In particular, and especially in this paper, I'm interested in how fertility, pregnancy, and parenthood shapes and is shaped by lesbian and queer gender, and above all, how this relates to femininity. So it goes without saying that at the beginning of the 21st century, across the West and other places, queer desires for life enhancement through reproduction is both enabled by and reconfiguring the use and meaning of reproductive technologies. At the same time, queer reproduction remains a testing ground for a range of both ethical, moral, legal, and cultural questions pertaining to how kinship is and can be perceived. In some places, in the public eye, queers have deployed both marriage and medicine and gone from being, let's say, barren monsters with unintelligible gender expressions who practice unnatural sex and remain outside of reproductive time, and thus who have no little use to the reproduction of the species or nation, to now becoming respectable, recognized, fertile, and thus potential mothers or parents, who wants what everyone wants, a family, at least if they have the right circumstances. At the same time, queer reproductive strategies of previous generations and those of of those who, for a range of reasons, mostly having to do with emotional, economic, cultural, intellectual, and political capital, or lack thereof, stand outside of access to technologies and recognition, or those whose family constellations reflected both a different kind of community and a different set of legal conditions, run the risk of remaining invisible or unintelligible. And as one activist that I interviewed a few years ago said, my greatest fear is that a younger generation will pity us older dykes because we didn't have the laws and technologies they do to have children. The thing we found was that freedom from reproduction was a relief, and we made family in other ways, being aunties and parents, godparents to queer youth. So here I am attending to a process that I am calling becoming infertile, in order to point to the simultaneously bodily and technological, discursive and material articulations involved in transforming queer reproduction in gendered ways. And I want to argue that the gendered and gendering dimensions of infertility, including and perhaps especially among queers, remains relatively understudied and tends to focus on the non-heteronormativity, which largely translates into non-normative femininity. I want to ask what a collective narrative of becoming fertile does to and for lesbian and other queer forms of femaleness, and to femininity in particular. If lesbians have gone from being monstrous to being maternal, can this simply be reduced to same-sex parenting, where we are caught in the discourse of the biological and the social motherhood, and its seeming overlaps and or differences from heterosexual gender ideals? Or is there something else going on? In short, I'm interested in how infertility becomes part of a queer gendered subject formation, and I want to attend to how it materializes in and through technologies, and of course, as an effect of both regulatory and queer regimes of power and knowledge. So before I get into some more of this, let me just say a few things quickly about the larger context of this, which is that this my project is part of a larger project called Queer and Kinship in the Baltic Region, where I'm working together with other people who are here today, in order to offer new theoretical and empirical perspectives on queer kinship and reproduction in and across post-socialist Northern European or Baltic settings that are characterized by very different legal regulations and histories of queerness and so on. For me, what's particularly interesting is the affective dimensions of kinship and its regulations and practices. That is, not wanting to make a huge theoretical distinction between affect and emotion, that's a whole discussion in and of itself. I am interested both in the work that emotions do in reproduction, how they shape and are shaped by understandings of who is related and how what a meaningful life and future looks like, and through what practices they are mediated in. And also in, you know, the kinds of affective investments that people have, and, you know, that also sometimes lead to surprises of various kinds. For instance, when, you know, the not gay as in happy but queer as in fuck you isn't the fuck you the heteronormative, but fuck you the person that I thought I was planning a life with. And we've heard more about this before, so I won't go into that. But, you know, the whole kinds of unexpected emotions and affective investments that we have in various ways of understanding kinship and reproduction. So I want to draw on a large body of work, which, as many have pointed out, tends to be very Anglo-American dominated. And I want to focus, as I suggested in the beginning, on different age cohorts of queers and how they've sort of solved these different things. And even though this Anglo-American model of chosen friend-based alternative versions of We Are Family, which in Sweden at least is always invoked somewhat ambivalently as all American concepts, even though this concept is used as a slogan and organizing metaphor for queer community making, I think that in a queer age of reproduction, there are new alliances and divisions that are being created, and it seems like no longer are we all family, or certainly not in the same way. So Agnes' version of the four-parent family, conceived at the dawn of new laws at the turn of the millennium, represents what Caught in her interview called the old-fashioned model of active fathers, which her and many others have explained is far from the ordinary thing. As one informant said, why complicate things? It's hard enough to imagine commitment to one person for life. So it's actually opening up for some things and closing down for other things. You know, and the whole range of questions that are being raised for gay men in Sweden, where many will argue that there's actually fewer reproductive options now than there used to be before. And then again, other things that people are raising about the sort of the shortage of sperm, so that, for instance, it's very difficult to get brown sperm in Sweden. So if you have a family that doesn't look white and Scandinavian, you may have to make other kinds of choices if you have the resources. So what I'm interested in is really what is being reproduced through queering reproduction, and what are we reproducing in researching the queering of reproduction. So what I want to focus on today, more specifically, is gender. And I think these are fabulous pictures, by the way. Here's some more. So let me talk a little bit about an artifact, which is a recently published illustrated Swedish novel called Last Night I Dreamed I Was Pregnant, which chronicles the author Sara Elgeholm's efforts to get pregnant while simultaneously practicing what queer feminist activists in their 30s called relational anarchy and polyamory, and aspiring to form a star family rather than a nuclear family. And this, I think, is an artifact of contemporary Swedish queer feminist politics and cultural production, because it's something that circulated widely, and I think it says something about what's going on in terms of imagining fertility, gender, and family in Swedish settings. So this book is set in the southern town of Malmö, known for its significant-sized immigrant population, where a white genderqueer character named Sera approaches the dreaded age of 35 and decides to realize the lifelong dreams of pregnancy, together with a group of other white androgynous genderqueer characters. In contrast to the time when Agnes was becoming infertile, this generation is becoming fertile in a context where there is a range of reproductive options and they have come of age in an era of rights. So the main characters, aside from all being white and genderqueer, all have creative professions and university degrees, live according to leftist political values, travel the world, have access to countryside summer houses, and choose vegan and organic food, and from a range of daily social and health-related activities. They are, of course, equipped with strong critiques of heteronormativity, despite hardly ever actually encountering it in this book, which is interesting. And to them, choosing a family of friends or choice is easily done over the family of origin, because their conservative values clash so intensely with their own. Repeatedly throughout the book, there's a strong distinction set up between the norm, cisgendered, coupled, nuclear, parenthood, family versions, and radical alternatives, genderqueer, communal, processual, polyamorous, and democratic decision-making processes, with multiple parents and engaged adults. Now, the interesting thing is, of course, that the future children of these queers will not be choosing families of choice. They will be choosing their own family, because, of course, they're not going to be reproducing the same model, which is another paradox, I think. So she tries a whole range of different options and eventually gets pregnant after eight inseminations by a private donor who claims to have incredibly good sperm, but nevertheless, and very frustratingly for the young fertile person, it takes eight times. And I think this is really interesting, because if you think about the concept of infertility, it is not like sterility or barrenness, which have sort of other kinds of cultural and medical definitions. Some will say that infertility connotes a medically and socially liminal state. It is the kind of not yet pregnant, ever hopeful of achieving pregnancy and having a baby to take home. So you can keep going and going and going until you run out of resources. So I would say that reproductive technology, in vitro conceptions and others, redefines the idea of reproductive capacity, and thus it is a precursor rather than a response to infertility. So Last Night I Dreamed I Was Pregnant suggests that in becoming fertile, as in becoming pregnant, is a kind of taken for granted line of flight towards life enhancement. There's a whole range of ideas and values that are being reproduced, while some are being challenged. Above all, it is about privilege. It requires flexibility, time to spare, financial, social, emotional resources, and a lot of negotiations. So in the Swedish context, queer and reproduction is both normative and not. It's a strategic choice to resist certain norms, a choice which also paradoxically seems to assume that the queer subject is indeed autonomous, and that structures of domination can be transcended on an individual level by stepping out of roles and transgressing boundaries. It also seems to uncannily presume a rational, autonomous, human, male subject who seems to have a lot in common with another subject we used to want to get rid of. Right? So what happened to femininity here? In Last Night I Dreamed I Was Pregnant, Becoming fertile is, as manifested in pregnancy, is narrated as a radical queer act and the refusal to perform heterosexual gender, in other words, femininity, is central to such a project. Indeed, in this particular subculturally circulated and celebrated queer vision of family and futurity, all characters are genderqueer. They have, as you can see here, they all have short hair, flat chests or bound chests, boyish clothing, and often gender-neutral names. And even though there's a whole range of various kinds of emotions that have to do with Sarah's worries about becoming more like a woman through her pregnancy, it seems that becoming mothers and parents, there are some dimensions of what we might call female morphology that can be included, perhaps even being a woman at moments, but very few of them have anything to do with feminine gender expression. In fact, several younger couples that I've also interviewed have spoken to how butch femme is stereotypical, old-fashioned, and heteronormative, and how they hate being read as women in the feminine sense. So that, interestingly, the book's message also seems, which is also, I think, reflected in political and cultural popular debate, we are seeing an increase in trans and masculine-identified people being the ones who are becoming fertile, and that as being the kind of cutting edge of gender transgression. While the discrimination faced by those who transgress feminine norms of pregnancy is increasingly and importantly becoming object and subject to debate, study, and policy, is of course very, very important and crucial, it in many ways also extends a longer feminist project to displace the alignment of pregnancy with a particular gender construction of femininity. Canadian queer sociologist Michelle Walks calls the association of femininity with reproduction, including but not limited to pregnancy, breastfeeding, mothering, and fertility, as a cultural fetish. Pregnant women or bodies, she suggests, quite rightly, conjure up significant value both as icons, commodities, and through reproductive power, all of which relates to feminine pregnancy, something that is thus both fragile and powerful, she says. So she extends the longer tradition here, which seeks to challenge this, and she wants to argue that reproduction associated with the female body is not exclusively considered a feminine desire and experience, and of course it isn't. But interestingly, for Walks as well as for a range of other scholars who have published work recently, it is the masculine presenting people who more than anyone explicitly challenge the cultural fetish associated with femininity, that associates femininity with reproduction. So differently put, the way to challenge the cultural fetish is to get rid of its feminine connotations. Now, as you can imagine, for a femme academic, this is really kind of interesting and somewhat troubling. And I'm sure there are some femme mamas in the audience who may perhaps agree with me on this one. Now, we could speculate as to why it is that we have this cultural fetish. Of course, the etymological roots of fertility are certainly fertile food for feminist thought. And I'll just leave that up there and skip the discussion of this. But, you know, we see where this the kind of cultural connotations come from. This is, of course, linked to female feminine happiness, unless it's linked to single womanhood, poverty, bodies that are too old or young, or overpopulation, right? So globally speaking, infertility remains culturally understood as a woman's burden, as several people here have pointed out. But as Laura Mamo has argued, infertility also regulates ideas about normal and deviant sexuality, gender, reproduction, and family. Importantly, Laura Mama also reminds us that it is so-called barren women whose bodies were the objects of discourse on deviation, who were the very bodies that were used to experiment and develop these new technologies. Differently put, the very invention of reproductive technologies are barren women's bodies, we might say. They are irreducibly tied to gender and thus to conceptions of sexuality. Both fertility and infertility are the effects of sets of relations mediated in and through technologies in which barren as in deviant femininities have become the testing ground. Against this backdrop, I think arguing for masculine bodies becoming fertile might seem like both an important and kind of complicated move. Interestingly, it is through the associations with inversion and perversion that lesbianism in its stereotypical forms has been seen as the antithesis to fertile femininity. And of course, many papers here have alluded to this. Cast as predatory, manly, refusing heterosexuality, marriage, and children, lesbians have been deemed naturally and legally unfit for motherhood, and due to their orientation, by some theorists, even deemed to not be women. At the same time, it is precisely their close proximity to heteronormative femininity that has made femmes seem both inauthentic lesbians, dangerous, suspicious, bisexual, not quite committed, and also, of course, incredibly privileged because they pass as heterosexual women. Interestingly, debates about access to ARTs also seem to produce new deviant subjects in the form of lesbians. For instance, in Denmark, it's been noted that the official that the discussions about who should have access to reproductive technologies has led to an official birth of the lesbian, a subject who, in the Danish context, had rendered little prior attention because the homosexual as a problem tended to be male, which suggests that lesbians becoming perceptible and also simultaneously potentially monstrous is done through kinship and access to reproductive technology. So the lesbian is not a sexual subject, but an unnatural mother in this discourse, according to Mette Bryl. And according to Nina Lykke, there are two kinds of lesbians in the Danish debate. Those who were considered to be responsible and that didn't need medical assistance or have any medical problems, and who were attempting to have something like a father present, and those who refused to have a father present at all and just want the technology. Now, interestingly, while seemingly monstrous in their refusals to follow the law of the father, in these debates, the lesbian was becoming fertile and mother as a singular category. As recent studies of lesbian and queer kinship and my own work also shows, even if there are more than one womb present in a family, it doesn't always mean that there are two women who wish to become fertile, or that it doesn't matter which one of them does, for the sake of pregnancy. Michelle Walks also shows that masculine-presenting people who experience pregnancy are often met with confusion, even in LGBTQ communities, which to me is another reminder that it's really hard for all of us to think kinship outside of heterosexual gender, to think pregnancy outside of femininity, and that there is, of course, something monstrous about imagining a masculine body pregnant. While we could argue that these cases illuminate a society that is having problems moving beyond thinking that kinship is always already heterosexual and based in sexual difference, I want to stay with the queer nation, within the queer nation, and push a little further when it comes to thinking about femininity, and in particular queer femininity, and how it does or does not relate to fertility. Because it seems to me that in both Last Night I Dreamed I Was Pregnant and in other queer work, it is femininity in all its heteronormative expressions that have to be left behind.
How am I doing? Five minutes.
Okay, I think I should be able to do that, maybe. All right, are you with me? Am I running too fast here? Okay. Again, workout sessions. Right, so my desire to linger with the topic of femininity and its relationship to fertility, pregnancy, and kinship, of course, extends my decade-long interest in theories of femininity and fembodiment, and in the figure of femme in particular. This figure, as many know, is far too often read as too straight, too privileged, not authentically lesbian, and so on. Bearing in mind that reproducing queer futures in Sweden, despite access to welfare state benefits and recognition, is always stratified and complex, and that much more needs to be addressed in terms of this, I want to argue that the process of becoming infertile, engaging with a condition or technology or bodily discourse like infertility, produces both old and new forms of queer femininities. Globally speaking, experts like Marcia Inhorn have reminded us, infertility and childlessness has social consequences, particularly for women. It's a likely cause for divorce. Infertile women are more likely to be subject to physical, emotional, and verbal violence in heterosexual settings, and divorce may in turn push women out of family folds and even into prostitution, researchers are arguing. So culturally and historically, the failure to become pregnant, which is of course always a feminine problem, has interestingly also been tied to shame of a feminine and sexual kind. It is at times its cause at times viewed as an effect of promiscuity or prostitution, not unlike how adultery has become a cause or excuse for unfit motherhood. So being barren, like the tree or the womb that doesn't bear fruit, we could argue, involuntarily queers femininity. At the same time, there are a range of femininities that are not becoming fertile in the right way in contemporary Western settings. Trans women are cast as the users of gestational surrogates if they freeze their sperm, for instance, or other reproductive materials, and are sometimes painted as the enemy of the radical feminist lobby who want to regulate surrogacy in Sweden. That's one example. Nina Lykke also argues that in addition to the lesbian, in the Danish debate, there were multiple types of abnormal women and femininities who weren't able to conceive in the natural ways that were conceived. The incomprehensibly ugly woman who seeks or is forced into single motherhood as a result of failing to find a man is one. Now, the incomprehensibly ugly woman, right? That's such a wonderful... because she doesn't have a man, that means she must be incomprehensibly ugly. So that was one. The other one was the career woman who, out of pure selfishness, has put off having a child until it is nearly too late, and who is bad and who is obviously without right maternal instincts, and who has chosen a lifestyle focused on consumption is another one. These, while clearly potentially very privileged positions, are also not proper heterosexual feminine desires for or expressions of fertility and pregnancy. One, because it doesn't partake in the heterosexual game, and the other, because it tries to beat men at their own game. I wonder about other forms of undesirable fertilities as well that are being produced. Teenage queer girls who get pregnant, racialized immigrant women who are cast as being too fertile, overpopulating the nations, sex workers who happen to have babies, promiscuous girls, so forth and so on. There's a whole range of kind of queer femininities that are becoming both fertile and infertile here. So from a range of global, intersectional, queer, and feminist perspectives, challenging the cultural fetish that links femininity and its value to fertility and pregnancy, and now in turn to motherhood, is of course a worthwhile project. But to the feminist question, to my mind, is on what grounds and to what ends? Because it seems to me that both feminist and queer theory and politics continues to have a vexed relationship to femininity, and especially to the parts that remain culturally tied to fertility and motherhood as iconic values. So is it only possible to imagine motherhood if we take the femininity out of it, in a queer sense? So it's a surface construct, a false ideology, a value, it can be cast off. There seems to be only two options, passing for hetero or appearing monstrous. And for queers, the latter is often the desired route. While the tradition of maternal thinking in feminist theory has sought to change the value of femininity as pregnancy and motherhood, the queer approach has largely been focused on dislodging those from femininity. If the former tends to essentialize femininity as difference through pregnancy and fertility, and presume a theory of gender rather incongruent with queer reproduction, I think the latter tends to see femininity as such as the problem. I think there's a tendency in some recent work to reflect and extend the queer tradition of hierarchies of transgression, where the non-normative, which coincidentally is often articulated by the white middle-class subject, is presented as seemingly inherently more liberatory. As Biddy Martin's once noted, there's a tendency to valorize cross-gender identification as exemplary of mobility and differentiation, which the femme presumably cannot. Are we running the risk of reproducing misogynistic attitudes towards femininity to the point of complete disavowal? Now, if becoming fertile is no longer inevitably means becoming feminine, but rather a move from it, then can femininity only be queer if it involves becoming infertile? Can we envision a queer feminine woman carrying a child but not being its mother, but rather its breadwinner? I'm thinking also, of course, here of the kind of kin work and reproductive care work that femmes are doing to their butches, with or without kids, that mommies are doing to boys in BDSM communities and elsewhere, what girls are doing to their daddies as kind of other sorts of alternatives here. I think femmes who have carried children as well as fostered, adopted, auntied, step-parents, parented, do tell very different stories about what it means to be fertile, feminine, and maternal. They speak about both fierceness and vulnerability, about subverting the cultural fetish of pregnancy and fertility in subtle ways, and about survival beyond the dichotomy of norm and deviance passing and disrupting. Now, while I personally happily reclaim the idea of femme barrenness and embrace the curse of queerness, and while failure is a queer art, it seems to me that we still have a lot of work to do when it comes to thinking and rethinking fertility, pregnancy, and motherhood and their links to queer femininity. Thank you.
Thank you. very short coffee break.
Okay, so then 20 minutes? Okay, so we have 20 minutes for questions.
And then the party.
And then coffee, yeah, party, and lake, and everything.
It was a direct question for Christina, actually, about when you, and I might have misheard, that's why it's a clarification as well, is I think I heard you say that you found it easier to recruit poly women, which you found surprising because they had less of a voice in sort of the literature and in terms of the present in community. And I just wanted to sort of ask, well, where did the 70s... separatist communities, all of the lesbian studies, polyamory readers, all of that history, going that characterization of lesbians not being poly. I mean, I'm not saying they're more or less, it's irrelevant, yeah. But I wonder where that's gone in that, or did I miss here?
Can I just... Yeah. Okay. No, you heard everything, but the connection, the link, you missed it. So I did say those things, but not as one justifying the other. What I said was, yes, I'm finding it easier to find women, self-identified women participants for the poly study. And that might be related to the fact that traditionally women have had less of a voice, not in the poly or in the lesbian, women, less of a voice in terms of telling us their stories, their intimate sexually based stories, because there is this fantasy that women are not sexually active, women are not, despite all the literature explaining us otherwise. But so historically women have lacked that possibility of being more public about sexuality, and maybe that's one factor that may account for the fact that women in Portugal, Spain, and Italy are volunteering more for this study than men. But it's, you know, it's very early days to tell if that is the case. That is one factor that I identified as a possibility of explanation. But I don't know.
I'm going to make you a question as well about this.
You will.
So that we wait a little bit. For the rest, when you mentioned, it is not so much about having a heterosexual couple, but about being monogamous.
Yeah.
I mean, I know that this is not a question of like you more or I more or no. It's a question about differences, right? For example, when talking about polyamory, and this is what is happening with the fieldwork in Madrid and
yeah.
and the rest of the cities, it's like, and also from our own experience, it's like it's so difficult to be a dyke and to be in a polyamorous relationship because we don't have so many spaces, we don't have so many places to go and find other people, you
yeah.
know, so it's very difficult that we don't know each other, that we don't go to a bar and find or bump into an ex-lover, and so I think that there are differences as far as like dykes or gay men and heterosexuals
mm-hmm.
Are concerned, and one issue can be this, like the availability of having spaces
yeah.
To have social encounters and so on,
yes.
you know? So it's
yeah.
not only about like poly or monogamous, but also like
yeah.
sexual orientation is really like
totally
intersecting there.
Yes, that's why we wanted to take not just a polyamorous study, but a polyamorous study within the lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, self-identified participants, because we're talking about accumulating layers of vulnerability and invisibility in a way, and the lack of specific spaces to socialize, as you pointed out, is one main factor. I mean, in Portugal, for instance, you have one big Facebook group, okay, but and you have a small organization, but you don't have meeting points, you don't have regular venues where people just go and know where to meet others.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas in Italy, for instance, there are more groups, more activist groups than in Portugal. But, you know, still, yeah, absolutely, I agree with your comment.
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions?
Okay.
just want to make a comment about the idea of family, because I was listening to Cristina, and you talk about relational citizenship, intimacy, care, but you never talk about family. And then I was, oh, thank God. And then, yeah. And then Ulrika touched the question about the American aura of this concept, because it really bothers me that we claim the concept of family, because it kinds of, okay, this is new types of family and etc. Because this preserves this aura of sainthood of family, as in inside the families was not about a lot of oppression for any of us. So I really like the idea of thinking beyond this concept, because this American idea to transform everything about family. You watch RuPaul's Drag Race and they are talking about family and new family and building a new family all the time. You know, so I just think refreshing, not thinking in these terms. I don't know if you have some thoughts on that.
Well, I mean, I think that my point there was that on the one hand, there is this long history of arguing, as we've heard across several panels here, of queers creating family in other ways, you know, fostering, caring, helping raise the children of others, and, you know, also, you know, I would say, I would also extend it to sort of intergenerational, you know, ranging from erotic kinds of raising of youth to, you know, other things. But now I think what's happening in Sweden anyway is that there's becoming a huge stratification between those who are creating family through the use of various kinds of reproductive technologies, and as has been noted, I think all forms of reproduction involve technologies of one sort or another. But those are, you know, both kind of voluntarily, you know, singling themselves out and pushing a particular kind of agenda, and I think this is really interesting, and I think there's a kind of privatization going on some levels. Now, then, of course, that doesn't mean all families look the same, and as my examples show, I mean, people do create families in all kinds of ways. But I think, you know, and maybe with the example from last night, I dreamed I was pregnant, you could say that that is actually an active strategy to create a different kind of family. But I think that what is being reproduced is a set of values that are not challenging, you know, whiteness, privilege, education, enlightenment, so forth and so on. What is being challenged is a very conventional family form. And I don't want to sort of discount that political strategy, but I do want to say that it's not something that I think is what everybody wants or is able to, you know, who can discount. I mean, this is why I think it's so interesting that this particular story is set in Malmö, which is a very diverse city with, you know, a large working class community of color, you know, where people's notions of family look really different, and people's resources, and even the very ability to travel across to Denmark, which a lot of people think of as a very obvious strategy for reproduction, is not something you can do if you're not a Swedish citizen, because you can't, you know, you have to pass a border, you know. So there's a lot of kinds of assumptions about what it means to be a young queer person, and where fertility, you know, some people will say resistance is fertile. So I think we need to do a lot of unpacking what it is that we're resisting, and what, you know, what kind of fertility it is that we're imagining.
Yeah, I just want to comment briefly on that, and to go back to Jackie's point, because I kept thinking throughout. Okay, yes, I take your point totally, and I understand where you're coming from, because yes, and I think we are pretty much on the same page there. But there's this important Portuguese sociologist, which everyone from Portuguese-speaking countries know of, called Boaventura de Sousa Santos, and he says something like, it doesn't matter so much the names you put into things, but the things you put into names, into categories. And I sort of, you know, because sometimes we are a bit caught in the purely theoretical debate about notions and concepts, yeah? And that takes away a lot of energy and time, and it is important. It is important theoretically and politically, but in a way also distracts us from doing the work, you know. So I try not to dwell so much on that. It's fine. If people want to use family, they do. If they want to use it, it's fine. But that's my personal stance. And in my team, we have many different views about the same topic. So sometimes some of us will use, family, and others will go, no, let's move on from that. And yeah, and we find a way to work from that. Just to comment briefly on Jackie. Also to do with the context, the Southern European context, because now, in the 70s, we were still struggling in Portugal, with the longest dictatorship in Western Europe, 48 years of dictatorship, which was over in 74. So no, we didn't have that story. So that's absolutely, that also helps me justifying it. So thank you.
So just to follow up on this question of naming, there's this scholar, Charlotte Lind, who says that there is a dramatic difference between telling a story about how one became a neurosurgeon than a story that explains what a nice girl like you is doing in a place like this. And sometimes using family can be actually an act of passing while doing whatever one, kind of would like to do, and forming or putting the contents that one would like to put into whatever. Strangely enough, I can understand how you kind of, use concepts, kind of normative concepts, just to have people lay off your back and just, you continue with your life. And I'm thinking about a paper that I think Kitzinger and Wilkinson, I'm not sure I'm referring correctly, were writing on behalf of marriage, writing about how marriage, like they're a lesbian couple, used to be a lesbian couple, how it allowed them to actually live in different continents, be polyamorous, and do whatever they like, but not having, for example, this border control, the possibility of not moving with each other to different kind of jobs and positions. And so, it's probably too complicated in that sense. So I would just to continue this conversation that also goes on in my head while using these terms. I'm not sure I want to kind of get rid of this concept. I'm not sure what I want to do with that, but I don't know this.
I think we need to be strategic. A girl's got to do what a girl's got to do. Not, girl as in girl. It's got to do with that strategic use of notions, given the audience, given our aims. Jeffrey Weeks used to speak about the identities as fictional, right? They are fictions, but they are necessary fictions. So you use them to the extent that you need to use them, although you already know that they are fictions, but still you don't lose sight of their potential in generating change. So for me, that's pretty much how I see it, but of course there is a tension. We don't ever move away from that tension, I suppose.
I have a question as well.
Yeah, I was just wondering what the similarities and differences could be between Northern European countries and Southern European countries, because going back to this image that you showed from the book as picturing the lesbian community, let's say, as pretty much genderqueer, I don't think that translates so easily to Southern European countries. You know what I mean? This gender mark is so much more powerful. If you go out in the scene, for example, in Madrid, what you find is a lot of femmes. It's just it's very difficult to be or to find masculine dykes. You know what I mean? And I guess that is pretty much the same, as far as I know, in Portugal, also in Italy, So depending on the context, of course, this problem of that femmes have, or we share, of being accused to be able to pass, is common. It's just I've heard this from my friends as well. But I don't know whether that can make some differences in your analysis. You know what I mean? Obviously, not all these feminine women are involved in butch and femme couples or relationships or desires, and not all these feminine women are queer femmes, we wish. But still, it's just like you are out there. It's just like the difficulties to be visible and in the way of like showing that you're a dyke. You know what I mean? So maybe in the Swedish context, there is this like this difference.
I mean, of course. I mean, you know, as all my work has been about, you know, what even constitutes butch and femme isn't, you know, isn't universal, but I think what has just been really striking to me is, and this is not new for looking at this particular material, but it just seems like both feminist theory and queer theory has always sort of had a problem with femininity. Queer theory likes femininity if it's in the form of drag, or if it's in the form of trans, but if it's in the form of cis and fairly normative, then it's just sort of a starting point. And I think that this is what's really still really profound in what Biddy Martin said in 1994. Why is it that this has to be the kind of the thing we have to hold stable in order to move, you know, and subvert and transgress? And now, of course, I'm talking specifically about the genderqueer lesbian sort of continuum. Mm. And I think that there's a lot of misogyny in society overall, and I in no way want to discount or belittle the amount of frustrations and challenges that trans and masculine of center people are experiencing who are going through pregnancy. In fact, there's a whole range of cases right now in Sweden where, you know, trans men who are pregnant are denied care because the computer says no, because you have this wrong kind of social security number and you don't come up as female and therefore they can't register you. I mean, it's just insane, like how incredibly normative the system is. So this is not against that. It's just that I find it really interesting that as a kind of both a political imaginary and as a theoretical problem, so to speak, it seems to be really, really hard to imagine femininity queerly, and I want to suggest that it is precisely in kinship and reproduction, because of, I mean, as we heard in the papers before lunch, like that's where, you know, people talk about maternal instincts, they talk about, you know, biological clocks, and you know, this is just this makes me more feminine and so forth and so on. And then a lot of people go, ooh, you know, why would you want that? Ooh, you know. And I guess, you know, 10 years of doing work with femmes, I just know that the kinds of investments that people have in femininity are not the same as those that are presumed to be attached to heteronormative motherhood. And I also think that mothers overall get a bad rap, you know, in a lot of ways, which again is not to suggest, you know, maternal thinking in the kind of classical sense, but I think we seem to be kind of going back and forth between, again, the sort of essentialism versus social constructivism, and we seem to think that if we can just get rid of, if we can just flush out femininity with a unified category woman bathwater, then, you know, the world will be a fabulous place. And I don't know that I agree with that, or I think it's interesting. And I think also that in Sweden, high femininity is... Yeah, it's sort of steeped in a certain kind of false consciousness, or it's understood in that way, that, you know, equality means, you know, showing that you're equally capable to the man, you can do everything he can, you can fix the car, you can do, you know, and any sort of association with femininity, even down to sort of like the kinds of discussions that lesbian and other queer parents are having about their own kids. It's sort of like, if you were to put a cisgendered girl in a pink dress, you know, that is the beginning of the end. You know, she will get a low-paying job, she will marry a man who's going to abuse her, and she will, you know, I mean, it's sort of, I think it's really fascinating that we have this fear of femininity, you know. So, yeah. That's my rant.
Okay, I think we've run out of time. So,
thank you very much.